गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज 17th May एंड द टाइम इज अराउंड 10:30 AM. आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस क्लास. दिस इज द क्लास फॉर सेकेंड सेमेस्टर जनरल इंग्लिश. लेट मी टेल यू वन थिंग बिफोर आई टेक द क्लास, आई मूव ऑन विद द टॉपिक. द पॉइंट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू मेंशन हियर. This class is not meant for postgraduate students or scholars. This class has been is being delivered. This lecture is being delivered by keeping in mind that the target audience is semester second students, particularly the students of Government Degree College Chhatru Kishtwar, which is obviously a far-flung area in district Kishtwar, Jammu and Kashmir. So I expect my viewers. I expect the students who watch this video or who are listening to me in this lecture to expect a very general lecture on Lal Did, Vak number 118 to 121. So the topic is, according to your syllabus, it's Vak number 118 to 121. It means we have to cover four vaks, four poems written by or attributed to Lal Did. I will say why I am using this word attributed instead of written in the coming slides. Before we move on to the vaks, to the poems, I suppose that we should have some basic knowledge about the poet. You can see on your screens that the poet was born in, Lal Did was born in Pandrithan near Pampur, Srinagar, Kashmir in 1326 AD circa. When I use this word circa, this is very important for the students to note. When I say circa, it means that this date, this year 1326, it is not final. It's not confirmed. It's an approximate year which is written on the screen. So we say that she was born in 1326. Or see, in the second line I have written, the second theory is, there is a second opinion about her birth, that is that she was born in Sempur near Pampur. Pampur is a place in Kashmir, you all know that. Some say that she was born in 1301, others say that it is 1317, and then there are some people who say that it's 1320. In the first line in the slide, I have written that it is 1326. So because the year of her birth is not confirmed, that is why I use the word circa, which means the approximate year. Approximately, it's around. If you ask me that, sir, what is the date of birth? What is the year of birth of Lal Did? I will say that it's around 1300 to 1326. In between these 26, 27 years, because we do not have proper record of that time. So there is some controversy related to her birth. She is believed to have died in 1373 AD. So again, I have written that it is believed that she died in 1373 because it's not confirmed. You can see a photo on the right side of the slide, a picture on the right side of the slide. This is believed to be her original picture. Although if you search for Lal Did's picture on internet, you will get plenty of pictures, plenty of paintings, but this one is considered to be an authentic picture. Though we cannot be sure about it, we cannot say that it's confirmed that this is the original picture of the mystic poet, but it is considered as one of the most authentic pictures if you see different sources. She's believed to have died in 1373. Her father's name is written on the screen. Chita Bhatt was her father's name. She was from a Brahmin family, a Pandit family. Her real name was Laleshwari. The real name of this poetess, this poet, was Laleshwari. This is second slide number two for you. She is considered as the first mystic poet of Kashmir. You can check the word mystic from your dictionaries. I am not going to into the details of this word. She is considered as the first mystic poet of Kashmir. She got married at a young age of 12 years She is affectionately known as, we know her by many names. If you go to Kashmir, you will see that people call her Mother Lala. Some say Granny Lala. Some say Lala Yogeshwari. Some call her Lala Arifa. And there are other people who call her simply Lala. Or the most famous name, that is Lal Dev, which all of you know. When she got married at the age of 12 years, these names are very important, which are there on the screen. When she got married at the age of 12 years, her name was changed by her in-laws to Padmavati. I have written it that it was, she was named Padmavati after her marriage. But as she was someone who was not interested in the worldly affairs, in the married life, she left her home at the age of 26 years, 26 or 27 years. She left her home and started wandering here and there in search of reality, in search of the meaning of life. Why she left her home at such a young age? Why she left her in-laws? Because it is, it is written in the records, it is written in the in different sources that she had a very cruel husband and mother-in-law. Her in-laws were very cruel. The reason was that Lal Dev was not a normal human being. She was a mystic kind of person. She was a spiritual person. She used to live in dreams, and all the time she was busy in her spirituality, in her, she used to think a lot about different issues, which will be discussed in the poems, which we will discuss in the later stages. There is a famous saying related to Lal Dev. In Kashmiri, it is Hond Martan Kin Hat. Hond Martan Kin Hat Lal Nalwat Chalnaza. I hope you might have listened. This is a very, very often quoted proverb in Kashmiri. Hond Marit Kin Hat Lal Nalwat Chalnaza. Some people call it Hund, some say Hond. It is, we pronounce it in Doda, in Kishtwar, we pronounce it Hond Marit Kin Hat Lal Nalwat Chalnaza. And the meaning is given on the slide in front of you. It's a famous saying. She says, it is said that one, she used to go to a village spring to get water in the mornings. There once it is said that her in-laws had, they had arranged a feast, a party for the people of the village. And when she went to fetch water from that spring, the women from her village, they started congratulating her that now today you have a feast and you will be getting a sumptuous meal, a very, very good meal. And she said, when she replied to those women, she said, Hond Martan Kin Hat Lal Nalwat Chalnaza. And the meaning is, whether they kill a ram or a sheep, whether they kill a ram or a lamb, Lala will get a stone to eat. Because it is said that when her mother-in-law used to give rice to her in a plate, she used to keep a stone under the rice, so that the people who are sitting there in the kitchen, the other in-laws, they will feel that she has a heap of, rice. She has enough quantity of rice in her plate, but there used to be a stone under the rice. So this famous saying is in that context. Whether they kill a ram or a sheep, Lala will get a stone to eat. If we go into the details, we will come to know that her name is first mentioned in Tadhkiratul Arifin. In 1857, this book was written in 1857. And in that book, Tadhkiratul Arifin, we read her name for the first time. The book was written by Mulla Ali Rana, who was the brother of the famous saint, the famous poet Makhdoom Sahib, who is very, very famous even now in Kashmir. You have heard the name Makhdoom Sahib. There is a shrine in his name in Kashmir. As far as the number of poems written by or narrated by or uttered by Lal Dev are concerned, there is a huge controversy on it. Some say that 300 vaks are attributed to her. Some say that 280, 250. So I have taken a number from a book published by Penguin. Penguin Publishers. It is around 258 vaks have been attributed to her. Now you will say, what is a vak? Vak is a name given to the poems written by Lal Devi. People say that vak is, some people say that vak is a poem with four lines, a stanza with four lines, but it's not always so. If you go through the poems which have been translated into English, if you read these poems, sometimes you can have five or six stanzas as well in Lal Devi's poetry. And it is very important to mention here that don't think that Lal Devi used to write in English. Or don't feel that she has herself written all the poems on a sheet of paper. No. You know, most of the vaks, most of the poems which are attributed to Lal Devi, they have an oral tradition. They have been orally transmitted from, transferred from one generation to another generation. And later on, they will compile together. Most of them were in Kashmiri, and they were compiled together. And then we have a translator, Ranjit. I will mention his name in the next slide. There are a few people who have translated those works into English, and we are going to study the translation of those works. And Lal Devi is one of the earliest known. These works are one of the earliest known works of Kashmiri literature, though a lot has been written in Kashmiri after that. But this is considered as one of the earliest piece of literature written in Kashmiri language. Now, I was mentioning the translator. The name of the translator is in front of you. This translator is mentioned in your syllabus as well. Ranjit Oscott. he is a poet, a cultural theorist, and a curator. And he is himself a poet, and he has written some poetry collections. Two names are there in front of you on the screen. I'm not going to read it. He has worked as fellow of International Writing Program at University of Iowa in 1995. I am talking about Ranjit, the translator of these works. And he was a writer in residence at Villa Wadberta, Munich, in 2003. This is something about the translator of the poems. So here is vak number 118 in front of you. This is the text. If you do not have text in front of you, if you are not able to arrange the text, here is the text for you people. Vak number 118. Poem number 118. So I will read the text of this vak, and then we will discuss and we will summarize it, and we will throw some light on the theme of this vak. Reputation. It's a water splashing in a creel. Find me a hero who can trap a gale. In his fist, tether an elephant with a hair. Maybe he would dare to hang on to reputation. This is, you know, Lal Devi's poetry has one peculiar characteristic feature, and that is epigrammatic style. Proverbial qualities are there in Lal Devi's poetry. She is talking about reputation. You know, we people are mostly, when we see that when we achieve something in our life, when we achieve something in our career, in our professions, we feel that we have, you know, created a very good reputation. We feel that we have created a very good impression, a very good image in this world. But Lal Devi says that this reputation is like water splashing in a creel. Creel is a basket. You know, a fisherman has a basket in which he keeps his fish. When he takes fish from the river, when he catches fish from the river, the fish are kept, they are kept in the basket, and the water comes out of that basket. I hope you understand. The basket, that creel cannot hold water. Only fish remains in that creel, and the water comes out. So reputation is like that water splashing in a creel. Or you can say when we use that sieve in our kitchens to sieve that flour. Aata jab hum goonte hain, uske liye jo channi use hoti hai. Aap maan lijiye reputation is tarah se hai jis tarah se channi mein aap pani dal rahe hain. जिस तरह से आप एक छन्नी में पानी डालोगे और उसमें कुछ भी नहीं रहेगा, पानी तो निकल जाएगा, उसी तरह से ये कह रही है, इट्स वाटर स्प्लैशिंग इन अ क्रील. रेपुटेशन इज लाइक दैट. आई मीन रेपुटेशन इज नथिंग. दिस इमेज विच वी फील दैट वी आर वेरी, यू नो, वी हैव अ लॉट ऑफ मनी, वी आर वेरी रिच, वी हैव अ वेरी गुड रेपुटेशन, दिस इज लाइक वाटर इन अ क्रील. फाइंड मी अ हीरो who can trap a gale in his fist. You can have people who can claim, you can have a hero, somebody who can call himself a hero, and he can claim that he can trap a gale. Gale is a strong current of wind. He can say that fist means this hand, mutthi. He says that you can find a hero, you can find someone who boosts off trapping the wind in his hand, trapping the wind in his fist, right? Or there can be a person who can boost off tethering an elephant with a hair. Tethering means to fasten with a rope. So a person can, you know, claim he can boost, that he can fasten an elephant with the help of a hair. I mean, somebody, this is literally, it means that to fasten, to tether an elephant with a hair, or trap a strong current of wind, to trap wind in one's fist. But symbolically, it means that we can claim to be very powerful. We can claim to be very rich. This is what the poet means. Or maybe he would dare to hang on to reputation. She means to say that we human beings have this tendency when we achieve something in life, when we are, you know, rich, when we have a lot of power, when we sit on powerful positions, when we are, suppose, you know, a king, a prime minister, a president, somebody who is very powerful, they feel that they have all the power in the world and they can do anything. But Lal Dutt says that this power, this reputation, this image, this is like water splashing in a creel. This can, you know, go in a jiffy. In a fraction of second, a king can be a beggar. In a fraction of seconds, in a few days, in a few months, in a few minutes, or in a few hours, you can see that a person who is very rich can be on the roads begging for money. See, we have this pandemic these days, this COVID-19, and we can see that very rich people who are very rich, who have all the luxuries of life, even they feel so helpless in front of it. So this is the power of the God. We will discuss that in the next walk. This is walk number 1118, which I have discussed in front of you. I will move on to the next walk, which is 1199, walk number 119. Or that person can to dam a flood. A person can claim to dam a flood, to stop a flood. To dam, dam has been used as a verb here. Dam, you already know, band, jisko bolte hain, jo pani ko rokne ke liye hum construct karte hain. To dam a flood. A person can claim to be very powerful, he can claim to be so powerful that he can stop a flood, or to blow out a forest fire. Or he can claim that he can, you know, stop a forest fire. There is a forest fire which is obviously very dangerous, and it gets out of control once we see our forests on fire. You may have noticed during summers, our forests in our erstwhile district Doda, this is a huge problem here, that hundreds of trees are, you know, they get burned in those devastating fires. So he says that a person can claim to be very powerful, and he can claim that he can blow out a forest fire. He can put an end to this forest fire, or to walk on air. Somebody can claim that he can walk on air, or to milk a wooden cow. But there is a wooden cow. Literally, it means that there is a wooden cow, and a person can claim to milk a wooden cow, to get milk from a wooden cow, which is obviously impossible. Nobody can milk a wooden cow. Nobody can walk on the air. Nobody can, just if there is a single person, he or she cannot blow out a forest fire, or he cannot dam a flood. But she says that people make these claims when they are powerful, when they are in the positions of power. That is why we usually say that power blinds a human being. It corrupts a human being. Now she says in the last line of this vak, she says any con artist could do it. She says these four things which are mentioned, to dam a flood, to blow out a forest fire, to walk on air, to milk a wooden gun, any con artist could do it. Anybody who is a trickster, who is a magician, he can do it. It's not a big deal. You don't need to be very powerful to do these, right? So in walk number 19, she is again in continuation to walk number 118, which is there in the earlier slide, which we have just discussed. She talks about those people who claim to be very powerful and who claim to do very, you know, who boast of doing very huge things and accomplishments in their lives. And she says that any con artist could do it. Anybody who is a magician, who is a trickster, who is very clever and cunning, he can do it. Now we have vak number 120 and vak number 121. We will discuss vak number 120 and vak number 121 in the next lecture, because I don't want to bore you with a long lecture. If you have any questions, you can contact me. You can talk to me. I repeat, there's this, these lectures are meant for UG students, that too for semester second students. And this topic is there in general English. It is not an English literature subject. So I have tried to be as simple as possible. I repeat, we discussed the poetess, Lal Ded, her birth, her death, her family background. Then we talked about the different names which are attributed to her. We talked about her leaving her home at the age of 26 years after getting married and after having a very bad married life. She had a cruel husband and a very, you know, tyrant mother-in-law. And then we talked about how she is mentioned in English, Kashmiri literature, how many vaks are attributed to her. And then we moved on to the translator, whose translations I am, you know, putting on the screen for you people. And then we discussed vak number 1118, which is about repetition. And in the same manner, we discussed vak number 119. In the next lecture, tomorrow, we will try to discuss vak number 120 and vak number 121. Till then, I hope there are no questions, but if there are any questions, any suggestions, any comments, you are most welcome. Thank you.